using some standard hobby glue, and I'm going to glue in very carefully. So I'm going to try to glue only on the sides of the paper which I've glued in a couple of days ago. I'm going to glue in these these circles made of transparent paper. These are going to help me diffuse the light of the LED of the engines. I've done some tests, and white LEDs look the best. These are now dry. That means the glue is dry, and these papers are now stuck on the engine bells, and you can't see them from the other side that they're a white paper. That's exactly what I wanted. Okay, this has been damaged, but that's no real problem because it's going to be weathered anyway. Right, what else did I did? Well, I cut out three of these circles from styrene. I used styrene. I'm not quite sure if I'm going to use paper, but for now I'm going to be using styrene. I've made some marks that you can see. The idea is that I'm going to fold them over, glue them, and then put the LED in here, and you see this is now a cone. And that cone is going to be glued inside the engine tubes. That means that whenever you remove the engine backing from the model, the LEDs and all the cables will go with it. That means I have to make sure that the cables are very sturdy and very secured, soldered onto the LEDs. That is the intention, and the advantage, of course, is that I have no problem now with this part. I don't have to figure out where the lights are going to be if they want to be in the dead center. I might have to cut out this one. No, wait a minute, I'm backwards. This is the right side. I may have to cut a few things here. I'm not quite sure. Maybe it'll fit anyway. So that means that there are no light leaks anymore, because I'm gonna paint the backside black, and these rings which I've made will actually help keep the cone into position. So I'm gonna glue now all the three of these things in this shape, and when that's securely dried, I'm going to add the LED and then solder up the LED so that all of them all of them have power. Sorry, I couldn't find the right word. The backside of the Viper, you've seen it several times before, and now I have included all the three of those cones I made. They're all glued in. I used some hot glue to make sure that they stay in, because some of them were a bit too small, so I used hot glue to make sure that all the corners are now fixed. Hold on. And as you can see, I have installed the wires and the resistors. I also used some socks. I'm not sure what the English word for it is, but these tubes, shrinking tubes, that's it, shrinking tubes, to make sure that no cable is touching each other, so there's no short circuit. Oh, and the cables themselves are connected with a black shrink socket, or shrink tube. The reason for that is because this entire section is going to be pulled out of the Viper several times, so I have to make sure that the cables stay put. The cables are not connected yet, because they need to be pulled through the engine compartment of the Viper. And one cable goes over here, one over there, and the third one goes over there. And on the other side, they will be connected together and then connected to the entire power system of the Viper. So, all you need to do now, of course, make sure the backside is now painted black, so no further light leaks. Then I can finish off the interior of this thing, so it's completely blacked out. Then I can pull in the cables, connect them, and that might be it when it comes to the backside. And then I have to, of course, make a complete power system in the Viper itself, but I can use the body for that. I've come to a decision, and it wasn't easy to make this decision, but it'll have to do. It has to be that way. What have I decided is I'm going to forgo the entire concept of having a battery in here and having the magnets and removable back. And the reason is because I made another error. This part needs to be on front of the engine block. I have drilled out two holes for these cables. Now, so far, so good. So when you want to remove the battery in the old situation, you take out this configuration. Sorry, you take this section, put in the battery and connect the battery and then put it back in. However, with this thing in place, and there was no other way, the cables will be stuck here. That will not be a real problem, but putting the entire thing back in the engine block might go well for the first time and maybe the second time, but it's almost certain that one of these cables is going to break sooner or later. When that happens, the lights will never work again and all the work will be done for naught. This was not what I intended to do, but I have been looking in all kinds of other configurations, and there is simply no other alternative. What I was trying to do was certainly going to one of these days break one of these cables. So it's just better to glue it all in and make sure it stays in. It's too bad for all the trouble I've done, but that's the way it is. So the entire idea of this battery is out of the window. That's too bad, but that's the way it is. So what I'm doing is I'm now drilling holes in the already existing holes where the rear landing gear is going to go in. These holes are for two cables, one red, one green. These will go through these holes and go forward where they'll be later be connected with the switch and the other things. Oh, maybe I'm gonna make the switch in the platform anyway. But that means that we have to take a red cable and a green cable of indefinable length. I'm not quite sure how long it's gonna be, but hold on, let me get one through. And as soon as those cables are in and secure, then I can glue in the engine block. Where's the cable? Oh, there it is. Glue in the engine block. Okay, that should be long enough. Okay, so the same for the green cable, and then, as I said, glue in the engine block and glue in the front section after I have glued in the turbines. And you happen to have a box or a wooden frame on which the Viper is going to be standing up. Well, on the flea market I found an old Revo model kit of a Tornado Tornado jet fighter. This is the display case on which the Starfighter is supposed to sit. As you can see, there are three batteries in there. I will need to open this up and add another battery pack for the 9 volts. But what it essentially is, it is a part of a diorama from Revel, the Light and Sound Tornado. Light and Sound, you may say, what does it do? Well, there is a speaker inside which gives you the sound effects of a jet fighter on a runway. It's not a Galactica or a Viper sound effect. I may be able to change the sound, but at least we have something to have the Viper standing upon. And I have done some preliminary testing. Let me give you a quick lowdown. This will be the Viper in its place, landed on this display case. And here we have one of the wings. And where's the other wing? There's the other wing.
So it fits nicely. Maybe I'll put some figures along, and maybe I will try to open up the cockpit. And when you push the button, well, as you can hear, it's very loud. It's a very crisp sound effect. It is not a Viper or a Galactica, but by adding a few minor details along the side of this diorama, I will be able to have a nice display stand for this Viper.
Okay, unfortunately something went wrong with the video camera. I was trying to record me putting on the first layer of white over the already prepared pre-shaded Viper. Yeah, that went wrong apparently. The camera didn't record that. So what you got now here is a Viper with a pre-shaded dark gray brown lines all over the panel lines and a very thin layer of flat white, which will act as a primer over that pre-shades. Now the next chapter will be adding a few and thin layers of gloss white over the hull, but trying to pinpoint the panels. So I'm trying to paint the panels as much as possible one by one. Not sure if that's gonna work, but let's first build up the pressure in my airbrush. And I'm going to use a low pressure of about 12 or 15 psi. Let's start with the wing. Hold on, let me see if I can actually zoom in a bit. Okay, some tests. Okay, that's one panel. Thin layers, not necessary to completely cover the wing. Now, I've been thinking about, before I started painting the Viper, what method should I use? I was considering painting the Viper silver, then using the hairspray technique, which I will show you in another video perhaps, which will allow me to build up some scratches. But I've been looking at the photographs of the studio model of the Viper, and that model actually does not have much weathering or any kind of scratches on it. So I then said, well, let's just use the pre-shade method. And as you can see, it started to white up a bit, but I'm using a very thin layer, and the shades are still coming through. That's entirely the idea, because as I said, I'm going to use several layers of paint to do the Viper. So it's going to be a lengthy process, but I think you'll like the result when it's finished. Several coats of white have gone on, and now it's time for a coat of light gray, but not all over this Viper. I have masked several points, two over here and one on the other side, because that is where on the studio model of the Viper there is a gray panel, apparently. So we're going to simulate that. Let's see if we can actually get it on picture. Ah, that's good. So I mixed some light gray in with the white, and you barely can't see it, but it is a grayish color. Okay, that's one. And on the other side, once again doing a very light coat. This will continue showing the pre-shades, which in this case of course is just what I wanted. Now I have still some light gray in here, so I might as well add some light gray over here just to dull down the color of the engines. A very light tone of gray. Okay, let's see how it turns out. So I'm going to remove the masks now. Some of these are from Tamiya tape, the others are from a very cheap painter's tape, which is not very sticky, but it'll serve its purpose. Okay, now we need to be careful not to damage any of the freshly coated parts. Yeah, well, it's very subtle, that gray, but you can actually distinguish it from the white. Hold on. I'll show you when all the tape has been peeled off. Okay, as you can see, well, it's a bit glossy of course now because of the wet paint, but there is a very slight other color now appearing, a little light gray. It's very subtle, and I'm going to go with a gloss white over it again, and apparently something went wrong over here. So I need to either spray paint this several coats of white or simulate some battle damage or some weathering over here. Quick update on the Viper. As you may see, I have now finished the painting of the Viper. That is to say, I have finished putting on the white layer over several white layers, actually, over the pre-shaded areas. Later found out that Vipers aren't supposed to be pure white, so I added a little bit of metallic color and a little bit of black to my my white and did a little spray over it. A bit more in certain places. Before I did that, I painted some colorization that is metallic with some black and some white over these areas, and then sprayed them again with that combination of white with a little bit of metallic, so they are a bit more in tune with the rest of the color. They're not supposed to be fully harsh on black or silver or gray. They're a bit easier in the color. So as I said, I've painted the Viper all the way, except of course for the details, like the interior details, like the little colorization and so forth. The same goes, and you probably haven't seen it yet, for the pilot figure. Let's see if I can get a bit more zoomed in. The face is finished. I have painted a ring of white over here and on the top. This is supposed to be a light which shines on the face of the pilot. This is a bit too big, this line of white, so it has to be a bit thinner, but I have to repaint the helmet itself and do some more detailing on his jacket. Right, now the next phase I'm going to do, and let me remove the Viper from its platform, is painting the platform. I have used some painter's tape to paint off the metallic colors on the side of the platform, and also this plateau, this plaque, as far as it goes to the background. That was my computer, sorry. I found this, which is at this moment three pieces of paper. This is a landing bay, not of the Galactica, but of a random sci-fi ship And it does resemble the Atlantic Ave, of course, when it comes to the landing platform, the landing tube over here. It's printed in concept mode, so it's not very bright. It's a bit, well, it's just to check if it looks okay. This is the exact size, by the way, as the let me show you, as this one is. Now, as you can see, this one, of course, looks like a platform in Germany, where it's supposed to be the Tornado, and this is on board the Galactica, and I have tested to fit it to see how it will look in its place, and it looks remarkably fine. It looks that fine even that the center line, if you can see it, the center line which runs over here on the platform matches almost to the teeth the center line of the painting. I just see that the center line is off center. That's a bit of a bummer. I thought it was up in the center. Let me see if I can actually do anything about it. Well, it doesn't make any difference, because as soon as this platform is printed by a professional printer, I will duplicate the lines over here on the platform as much as I can, so it looks like it belongs actually there. But it looks pretty nice. I checked it with the Viper in place, and even it's on this paper, it looks very, very nice. So I've, as I said, masked off this, and used some liquid mask to mask these lights. And now I'm going to put the first layer of paint on this platform, which is probably going to be flat black, because it's going to be used as a primer for the rest of the paints. And as soon as that is all painted, I have some more add-ons to the platform to enhance it and to make it look like it's a platform of the Galactica.